Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm recording about the Neo4j Data Science Library. We will talk about node embeddings. Similarly than the embeddings that we use in NLP or computer vision, a node embedding is going to be a low dimensional representation of a node. In this low dimensional representation, we will incorporate the attributes of that node together with the topology or relationship that this node had on that specific graph. You will see, according to the explanations I will give you, how the calculations, how we create the embeddings, that is slightly different, and there is some particularities that we need to consider in node embeddings, because, well, it's slightly different. While the concept is exactly the same, we take an object, which like image, a document, a text, which had a high dimensionality, and we reduce this dimensionality into a vector of less dimensions, with trying to not lose quality of representation of that object. This is what exactly we do in NLP or computer vision, but here we have some constraints that we will, at least we need to consider unknown, because it is slightly different working in this environment. Similarly, like in other components in the GDS library in Neo4j, we had different algorithms, but only one in production quality level, with this fast RP. The other three are still in beta, so we will not cover in this video. We will cover completely the fast RP, but you can extend the only difference is what is how they generate the embeddings based on, in some cases, in fast random walls, like node to bed, or grass sage that is just considering the features of the neighbors, and has GNN is considering the created based on graph neural networks. But yeah, still are not complete, they are not in production, so better, well, you can read the theory, which in some cases the documentation is a little bit complex and I would say opaque, but yeah, they are there. Probably the current implementation will be rolled out to production, but it's still not not sure. So yeah, probably it's not the best of the ideas to use it, or not to use it. You can take a look to the documentation and understand how it works in terms of the how you implement it, or how the code and how you implement the embedding generation. Is pretty similar to FastRP. You need to consider in some cases some additional parameters, so this is not change of that. The only thing is at the end, well, what is essentially the difference? The difference essentially is how they consider the relations in between the neighbors of an specific node, and also the features of that specific node, or the features of the neighbors nodes. Depending how those components are included on the embedding generation, this is what essentially marks the difference between the four algorithms that we have present in the GDS library. Again, we are going to cover FastRP. I will also post in the repository an example that provides Neo4j, which is part of the machine learning and NLP in the Neo4j database, in the Neo4j documentation, sorry, and then you will see how to apply this to KNN similarity to do recommendations, so you can see an example end to end. Here we will cover just the functionality and explain how the node works, the algorithm works. And you will see, I will try to explain you in detail why it's slightly different to do this in a graph database or in rather than do it with text or in a computer or with images, no? Or with computer vision problems. So one of the main not issues, you know, what we need to understand is that usually when we prepare embeddings for an NLP activity, we just depend on some independent examples for some distribution. Here, what we do is we use a graph with some configuration, topology configuration and node configuration. And this graph that we use to create embeddings is not going to be the same graph that we will use to generate predictions. So we will need to ensure that the embeddings that we generate are representative of the graph that we will be on which we will do the predictions. So that is making this slightly more complicated of than generate embeddings for images or NLP. You, for example, create embeddings for NLP. Well, you train a model which generate the embeddings and is capturing, for example, in case of transformers, the different distributions of tokens in multiple tests that we use to generate embeddings. And these distributions, they are not gonna change essentially. Once the if you don't change the technology that you apply, quarks or bugs or transformers or whatever you are going to use, once you generate embeddings, these weights that you have on the embeddings, they are not going to change. In this case, just introducing, as you will see later on the explanations, just introducing an additional node on the graph that you use to generate the embeddings change completely the weights or the embeddings that you generate with practically exactly the same graph that you used before, just introducing one node. That's make the embedded generation a little bit more complicated than when we want to apply to graphs rather than when we try to apply to NLP or computer vision problems. Okay, let's move to the first the only algorithms that we will cover, FastRP, fast random projection. It's a not embedded algorithm in the family of the random projection algorithms. Random projection algorithms is just that they follow the Johnson-Linderstroth lemma, which essentially tell us that we can project a high dimensionality vector into a log n, when n is the dimension of the high dimensionality vector, without losing representation capability, no? If you want to say that. So we can reduce the dimensionality of the original vector to a lower dimensionality vector without losing the ability of calculate the distance in between two points in the data set. So this we use it for several purposes. You probably know dimensionality reduction. This is the same principle that we use when we want to apply or to yeah when we want to apply dimensionality reduction. So take a look to the documentation. You probably even without knowing you were using the Johnson-Linderstroth lemma, and in this case the FastRP algorithm, the original one, is based on the same concept. In any case, what Neo4j implemented is a slightly different variant because the FastRP algorithm, the original one, is only considering the topology. When I say the topology is the relationships that a node has up to a level. This level is the number of iterations that we will run the algorithm. And then on Neo4j introduce a variant which considers where the property of the nodes is held. I will explain now how Neo4j did, and then you will see what is essentially the difference. I will explain first of all how FastRP works, and then on how Neo4j include the properties of a node in order to, as they say, enrich the embedding, providing a kind of how to say representation of the attributes itself. So to generate embedding with FastRP algorithm, we essentially initialize a random embedding of dimension n. This is the embedding's dimension. Let's say 128. We generate a random embeddings, and then on what we do is we start an iteration process in which we take the random embeddings produced for all the neighbors that are at this at distance, in the case distance one, and then we average, we create an average of this embeddings, and we add this average of the random embeddings originally generated to the neighbors at that level. We add that average of those embeddings to our random generated embedding for this node, and then we continue to the next iteration considering the neighbors of these neighbors, and then on we iterate the process n times. This means that we go n levels far from the original node, and at this time we had captured the information of all the neighbors of that specific node at to the level n, which is the number of iterations. So once we had this embedding calculated, we move to the next node and we start the process from scratch. We calculate the embeddings from level 1, level 2, level n. We create the embedding, the final embedding for that node, and we move to the next. With this, we have calculated the nodes for any, once the process is finished, we had a FastRP embedding calculated for every node in our graph database. Then on what once we had the FastRP embedding following the original algorithm, what Neo4j did is use two additional properties in the algorithm, with these feature properties, which properties of the node we want to use to enrich the FastRP embedding, and which ratio of the original FastRP embedding we want to modify with this property, with these properties of this node. So what we do is essentially generate another random vector considering the properties that we want to include. Can be all in this node, or it can be just a subset of them. And we generate another vector. Let's say, whatever. We use two or three properties and we generate another random vector. And we replace the using the property ratio, which is essentially a float in between 0 to 1. And then let's say that we say 0.2. This means that we will replace 20% of the FastRP calculated embedding with the embedding that we calculate using the properties. So you can see here on this small representation. The fast RP is providing an embedding which essentially represent the topology, the connections of that specific node, and the property part is this new embedding that we calculate using the properties of this specific node. And then on using the property ratio, what we are gonna do is just replace part of the topology embeddings with the property part, with the property embedding calculated with only the properties of this specific node. So this way, as Neo4j say, we are enriching the fast RP because we include on the embeddings also the properties of that specific node. Yeah, it's a, as the fast RP algorithms explain, they only consider the connections, they don't care about the properties we have, and this way it's clear that we are just including or providing a representation in the embeddings, which is generated according to the specific properties of that node. And then we are not concatenating, that's not we need to how to say, to make emphasis on this. We are not concatenating the two nodes, so this the final embed, we select a size of the embedding, let's say 128, and then from this 128 we will replace 20% of the vector with the property part. So let's say it's something that is easy to calculate. If you had a vector of 10 and you use a property ratio of 0.2, you will calculate a property dimension vector of 0, of 2 dimensions, and the fast RP algorithm will calculate a topology embedding of 10. And then on the final state, we'll replace the last two positions of the topology embedding vector generated with fast RP with the property with the two dimension vector generated from the properties of that nodes. In total, we will still have 10 dimensions, and the eighth first positions of the node is the topology, and the last two is the property part of the generated from that node. Okay, let's go that. So now to implement or to do the to generate the embeddings using code is, well, is as any other algorithm in GDS, is where we connect to the database. We are using as usual the sandbox. You can look at the previous videos how to create the connection. There is no change with that. We are using as well the AirPort database, so we are going to create a projection as usual. The projection, as I mentioned in previous videos, is the concept of view in a conventional database. So we choose a node, we choose a relationship, we can choose or not, if we want to, well, sorry, we choose as well a property of if the relationship has property. We can use later on as well this property to weight the impact on the embedding calculations of the property itself, and also we choose which properties from the node we want to include on the embedding itself. If you remember, the node airport had multiple, sorry, has multiple properties. I just choose some of them, those that had integers or numerical values, not to make it too much complicated. As I just Just I wanted to show you how to include it here. So we create the projection again. We give a name. We choose the node. We choose the relationship. Can be multiple relationships, and you choose as well the properties. It can be as well one or multiple attributes of the node. Now we calculate this, we estimate the amount of memory and time that is going to be required, and then on we just string the values. That is just generating a query, and we generate the values, and these values are in memory. We don't write them down back to the database. So we just call the fastRP string the projection. We provide an embedding of 256 and a random set if you want to repeat the values next time that you run the algorithm. And as you can see here, it's a conventional embedding, a vector, 256 dimensions, and an index representing, well, this is the node ID, just to link later on the if you want to write this embedding back to the database, which is essentially what we will do later on when we implement the embeddings as a part of the machine learning pipeline in Neo4j. And then on using the the node ID, we will write this as a property of the node itself. And then this is the conventional way to do it. We are not using the property of the relationship to weight the impact on the calculations of the relationship itself. You have here an example. If you want to include it and calculate the embedded, taking into account the property of the relationships as a weight, how to do the calculations in the fastRP phase. And as you can see here, once we do that, the values change essentially. It's not a big change, but there is a change on the embedding. On the values. And then on again, I give you here some links to go through the other three available algorithms that are in beta phase. GraphSage, which essentially is looking at the properties of the neighbor nodes to create embeddings. Node4j, which is based on random walls and calculating the probability that the current node for which we are generating the embeddings are included in these random walls that we are generating of the size n. It's one of the parameters on the node to vec training. By the way, there is a library in Python, node to vec, that is implementing this algorithm. There is some In the documentation of Neo4j, is also the research papers that you can use for documentation or to read the insights of how the embeddings are calculated. And HGNN is just using graph neural networks to generate embeddings. Again, as you see, it's pretty similar to any other algorithm that we had in GDS library. The way that we use it, the concepts are, in my opinion, a little bit opaque, no? Or not very clear how they are explained on the documentation, but well, in any case, all the mathematical theory behind and all this calculation is a little bit complex to understand. So if you don't want to go to the maths, just you can take a look as well how you can apply, take a look to the different parameters. There is not a lot. You can just, well, in fastRP at least, in the others there is much more attributes that you need to consider in the other three. In any case, my advice is just keep it a little bit on the fridge up to their own production before to use it, because at the end they will generate an embedding similar to what you are generating here, and you can cover this example. You will see that the embeddings calculated with the fastRP have good quality. And the other algorithms had the same problem that had this one, no? In terms of the how the problems that suffer the embeddings in graph neural networks. It doesn't matter which algorithm you use, all of them have the same problem. And okay, that's all. Thank you very much for watching the video or following me in the channel. And as I usually said, I will upload later on this note, these two notebooks to the repository, and you can follow or review together with the video. You can run in your own environment at your wish. Again, they are with the sandbox. I'm working with the sandbox. You can do as well with the Neo4j desktop. And well, finally, if you like the video, just give me a like and share the content if you consider that it's useful for other people, and subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before. Thank you very much, and keep in touch.